let's go to Colossians chapter 2. Let's go to Colossians chapter 2 today. And, you know, we're in a series right now called Expanding Our Capacity. Now, why are we calling it Expanding Our Capacity? The reason why is because once you grow into adulthood, you no longer have a reason to continue growing. Your body has stopped growing. For most of us, our mind has stopped growing because there are not teachers or parents or influencers who are pushing us to grow. And so what happens is because our body has stopped developing and our minds have stopped growing, or at least for a lot of us, we stop challenging our minds for personal growth, then what happens is spiritually, we also stop growing if we are not careful. For some of you listening, you've probably been a Christian for quite some time. Many of you, you're new to this. You're still in that young stage of your faith, and that's an exciting stage to be in. But for others listening, you've been a Christian for quite some time. And when you look and say, well, how much did you grow in 2018? I wonder what the personal answer to that would be. Because growth is something, and I want you to note this if you're going to take notes today. Growth is something that is not automatic. It is not automatic. You have to be intentional in your growth. So what we're doing for this new year is we're saying, okay, we want to grow, for example, in the area of love. And that's what the sermon was last week, the Good Samaritan. We want to expand our ability, expand our capacity to love people who don't look like us, who don't think like us, who do not act like us. We want to expand our ability to love people. Well, today we're talking about we want to expand our ability to grow in Christ, to be discipled. You know, there's a lot of talk in the church, and it's good and it's healthy, but the church is talking today a lot about, are we making disciples? Well, you know, really we have to back up and ask the question first, have you been discipled? Because if you have never properly been discipled, odds are you're not going to, in turn, make disciples. Do you understand where I'm going with this? So today I want us to examine Colossians 2, verses 6 and 7, and I want to see what the Apostle Paul says that spiritual growth, spiritual progress really ought to look like in our lives. And I love the way that the Holy Spirit penned these verses, because it's not just words, it's also word pictures. I mean, it's vivid, incredibly vivid imagery that we can understand what progress looks like in the believer's life. So if you're there, Colossians chapter 2, verse 6, as you know, I'm unable to see my Bible. I'm unable to read right now, so because I'm so limited in vision, I'll have to go from memory, and I'll do my best to not mess up on that, okay? So follow along with me. Colossians chapter 2, verse 6, he says, therefore, as you have received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in Him, rooted and built up in Him, and established in the faith, just as you were taught, abounding in thanksgiving. Praise God. What wonderful scripture. And I want us to unpack this today because there are deep truths in each phrase. I want you to begin, number one, with the great transition word in the Bible, therefore. Anytime you see that word therefore, you should immediately pause because something major just transitioned, okay? That is a transition word. And so particularly when the Apostle Paul writes therefore, you need to back up and go, whoa, what was that first section talking about? What did he just say in the 2, 3, 5 verses above that? And if you notice in Colossians chapter 2, beginning in verse 1, Paul talks about his great love for them pastorally. So I want you to understand about this text. When Paul writes this, this is not a command in the sense of you better do these things. All right? He actually references military orders in the previous verse, in verse 5, when he talks about being in orders, talking about being in rank. But these are not harsh commands. Listen to what he says. In verse number 1, he said, I want you to know the struggle that I have for you, for your growth, for you spiritually. You can hear Paul's great pastoral heart as he writes this. And I hope that as I talk about and expound this verse today, and as we talk about each phrase, I hope you will hear my pastoral heart, that what I want for you more than anything, more than for you to be successful or comfortable or you know, have that nest egg or have that retirement or have whatever it is, that house that you want or whatever the things are in life that you aim at or that you're working, more than I want any of that for you, I want you to be complete in Christ. I want you to be rock solid. I want you to be on firm ground. As he says in the verse before, the firmness of your faith, I want you to experience that. Why? Because life is going to pull the rug out from underneath all of us at some point, right? At some point, the winds and the storms are going to come to our life. And when those days come, it doesn't matter how much money you have. And it doesn't matter how successful you were. And it doesn't matter if you have the things in life that you've worked all of your life to get. What you'll need in those moments is God and God alone. And I want you to know what it is to be grounded in your faith. So let's begin in verse number 6. Therefore, the great transition. Therefore, just as you have received Christ Jesus the Lord. Now that received is a one-time thing. Understand the imagery that Paul is giving here. Just as you have received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in Him. There is a beginning to our salvation. Now, we were saved in eternity past because we were in the heart of God before the foundations of the world were ever laid. But in our short lifespan, in our short time frame, there was a moment that we confessed Christ and we believed in Him with our heart. And Paul says, from that moment, as you have received Christ, from that present tense of salvation, whether that was when you were a child, or as a teenager, or as a 20-something, or later on in life, whatever point that you got serious about the Lord, whatever point that there was a true conversion, there was the old man died and the new man was born. Old things passed away, everything became new. Whatever that point was for you at whatever stage of life. Paul says, as you have received Christ from that moment on, here's the point, continue to walk in Him. I want you to write this down if you're taking notes. For many Christians, salvation is the ending. That should not be the case. For us, salvation is just the beginning. Do you understand? This is a lifelong, thrilling, incredible journey that you and I are to be walking. Now, walk is one of the favorite phrases of the great Apostle Paul. He's going to use the term three times in the book of Colossians. In its sister book, the book of Ephesians, he's going to use it seven times. So 10 times just in the book of Ephesians, in the book of Colossians, Paul is going to instruct us, you walk this way. You walk in Christ. You walk in love. You walk in humility. You walk in unity. You are to live this way. Walk symbolizes the pattern of our life. The pattern of our life ought to be walking in Christ, His principles, His ways, His models, His truths, His word. So he says, as you have received Christ, that definitive time that you became a new person, so walk in Him. Continue the process. That's being sanctified. It's an ongoing, lifelong process. Never stop. And don't think just because you at one point got saved, you're done. Nothing could be further from the truth. There's a whole life to live in Christ. And now, notice verse 7. This is remarkable to me. He's going to give us four vivid, amazing pictures of Christian progress. Are you ready? Number one, he shows us a tree that is planted. Now notice what he says, rooted. I love that imagery. You know, when I think of my life and I think of where I want to be in coming years and where I want our church to be, you know, I don't know if there's a better word than for what I want in my life than the word rooted. I want to be rooted. What do roots do? Roots provide, no matter how large of a tree it is, roots provide stability, doesn't it? It provides strength so that when the winds and the storms come, that tree is going to survive. It's going to be fine because it is rooted. Roots also provide nutrients. It's going to keep that tree growing. It's going to keep it alive. It's going to keep it healthy. When I think, what does it mean for my life to be rooted in Christ? Oof. I think, no, Lord, I want my stability to be in you. You realize my stability today in Jesus is not founded in this church. This church could fire me and I would still go on to live for Christ. My stability is not in my ability to preach or do the things that I love. That's not where my stability is. Some years ago, before I became a pastor, I would preach everywhere. I'd go in all kinds of churches would invite me, and I would go preach in all these churches. And it was extremely common for me to be away preaching. And I remember one day the Lord came to me very softly, and the Lord said, Chad, I want to set you aside. I want to, this is what he says. I didn't realize then what he was meaning. The Lord said, I want to chisel some things off of you. And the Lord said, is it okay if you don't preach for a while? Oof. You know, I didn't immediately submit to that and go, yes, Lord, that would be fine. Whatever you want to do, Lord, do it in me. I didn't do that. It took a couple of weeks of me sensing, feeling like the Lord was saying, I'm going to take this away for a while. And slowly, as I prayed and thought and pondered, and again, I didn't really understand it all. I was very young. I was probably 17, something like that, maybe 18. And I said, okay, Lord. I said, if you want to chisel some things off of me, I give you permission to do that. And if that means not preaching here or there, that's okay. Again, you know, I didn't realize what I was saying. And you know what happened? I'm not kidding. It's like the very next week, it just dried up. No invitations. No one. Nothing. Nothing. I was stunned because I was preaching somewhere every weekend. Nothing. It went quite a number of weeks, probably a couple of months, nothing. Probably another month, nothing. And you know what the Lord was doing the whole time? He was just knocking some things off. A whole lot of pride, a whole lot of arrogance, a whole lot of thinking that preaching was my identity. It's who I was. It's, no. See, the Lord wanted to chisel a lot of those things off. And you know what I was so surprised at? The church that I attended, that was my home church, instead of being gone all the time, I was actually there. And even there, because when I was there, I'd be used. They would use me to do, you know, two, three things, and you know, I was always up in front of people. Since the time I was very young, I've just always been up in front of people. And all those months that I wasn't up in front of anyone, man, the Lord ministered to me. I fell so in love with this church. I fell in love with the fellowship with God. And I think the Lord understood that I was on a path of my identity and all that was stable to me. What gave me stability, what gave me strength, what gave me nutrients, it was the ability to preach. And the Lord wanted to correct that. And from that time on, I've never found my identity in preaching. I find my identity in my fellowship with Jesus. Does that make sense? So we are to be rooted. What does it mean to be rooted? It means that our stability and our strength and our nutrients, they come from Jesus and Jesus alone, not from his church, not from our job, not from our skill sets, not from the people in our life that we love or support us, not from our income, not from our investments, not from those things that are important to us. No, where does our stability come? It comes from Jesus and Jesus alone. Because Jesus, this is why Jesus said, I am the vine and you are the branch. You find a branch laying on its own and guess what? It's dead. It's got to be connected to the vine, right? You and I have to stay connected to Jesus. So when I think of my life and I think of my church and our ministry, and I want, and when I think of my family, when I think of me as a parent, as a husband, I want my roots deep in the rich soil of God's Word. I want to be so planted of the Lord that just like Psalm chapter 1 verse 3 says, you take someone who delights in the Word of God, someone who delights in the law of God. You know what Psalm 1:3 says? He'll be like a tree planted by the river, whose leaves does not wither, who prospers at whatever he does, who will be able to stand in the judgment day. That's what I want for my life. I want to be so rooted in Christ, so grounded in the Word, that no storm of life can topple me. No catastrophe can stop me. I met with some marketing people this past week, and I met with them last year when I could see, and they could not believe that I could not see, and they asked, did this happen all of a sudden? All of a sudden. Because, I mean, back in October, I was driving. Back in October, I mean, you know, I could go anywhere. I was just jump in my car and go. Now I have to use Uber. It's called Sadie. Sadie's my Uber driver, in case you didn't know that. It doesn't matter what comes into our life that's catastrophic or stormy, when your roots are deep in the Word of God, when your roots are deep in Christ Himself, no storm of life is going to topple you. You'll be like that tree planted by the rivers. Psalm chapter 1, verse 3. Next, not only does he talk about a tree that's planted, secondly, he mentions a building that's being built. We should be rooted and built up. A building being built. What's he mean? Scholars think that what he's talking about is our life should be so edifying that we're constantly adding layers of growth to our life until, like a building being built up, we just continue to go upward. I think that's exactly what he means. Makes me think of Ephesians 4 when Paul wrote that we are to grow to the full measure of the stature of Jesus Christ. And so I want to challenge you today, the ones who are truly growing in Christ are those who are constantly adding to their faith. And isn't that what Peter wrote? Supplementing our faith, adding to our faith these wonderful virtues of God's Word. That's what he wrote in, I believe, in 1 Peter. We are to add to our faith. It's not that we're adding on to salvation. No, it's because we are saved, we are adding more. It's those fruits of the Spirit that are adding into our life. I'm growing in joy. I'm growing in love. I'm growing in peace. I'm growing in meekness. I'm growing in long-suffering and all those wonderful, wonderful things. Gentleness and kindness. I'm adding to my faith. I'm being built up in Christ. Do you see the imagery? So you see, Paul is saying, if you're going to grow your capacity, if you're going to expand your capacity to grow in Christ, what does it look like? Number one, it looks like your roots are deep in Christ. We're in the rich soil of God's word. We're in the rich soil of Christ. And that way, when the winds of life come, we're okay. And it also looks like being a building, that we're constantly adding layers, constantly adding floors to our spiritual growth. I love that. We're always being edified. As the book of Jude teaches, we're praying in the Holy Ghost, building ourselves up. That is adding to your faith. Number three, this is wonderful. And established in your faith, just as you were taught. The word picture here is of a classroom, of a school. This is wonderful. Now, some of you are like me, and I did not particularly enjoy school. Some of you are uber weird, and you loved school. Go figure. But not me. I was not a good student. Some of you were, and I commend you for that, and I hope my kids are. I hope they are not like me in that regard. However, what God has taught me through the years is do not despise His classroom. Don't despise His classroom. How many of you know that there are lessons that the Lord teaches us through life? And just like the children of Israel, if we don't learn our lesson, we will repeat the lesson. Well, he says we are to be established in our faith just as we were taught. This is God's classroom. I know for the last 2 years, God has had us in a classroom of prayer. 2 years ago, this is beginning the third year, the Holy Spirit spoke to our leadership and said, I'm going to teach your church how to pray. I'm going to teach you how to wait on the Holy Spirit. You know, these have been lessons, very long lessons, that I have enjoyed learning. When the Lord said, teach us how to wait on the Lord, I thought that meant services. I thought that meant that, you know, we would come in here and we would wait on the Holy Spirit to come and move. And I think that was part of it. And hopefully, God willing, we've learned a lot in that. But do you know what I really found out it meant? The healing of my eyes. See, now I'm like David, and I'm saying, Lord, I'm waiting. I'm waiting on you. And see, there was a phrase that David would use that I never really understood until this trial with my eyes. David would say in the Psalms, I'll wait all the day long. I'll wait all the day long. And you know what? That's becoming my prayer. I'm beginning and I'm learning. See, I'm in God's classroom right now. And I'm beginning to say, Lord, whether I can see or whether I can't see, I'm very happy. I'm quite content. And I mean that. There are days I struggle. There are days I get frustrated. Days that are harder than other days. But I'm telling you, probably 95% of my days are joyful, productive. I'm thankful. I'm so thankful. See, I'm in God's classroom right now. He's establishing my faith. I'm being taught how to wait upon the Lord. And whatever that looks like, however long it is, that, none of that's for me to decide. No, no. My job is to do what Paul wrote. Whatever state I am in, I will be content. You know, not everyone knows that. That's why Paul said, I've learned the secret. Because not everyone knows that. Where do you learn that? In God's classroom. Established in the faith. What's God teaching you right now? And rather than looking at your trial, rather than looking at your circumstance and going, oh God, why me? No, maybe God's really trying to teach you something of great value. And if you would look at God more so than someone who's angry at you, but look at Him as a wise teacher, you wouldn't be asking God why. You'd be asking God, what do I get from this? What are you doing in my life? What do you want me to learn? What do you want me to know? Amen? And then lastly, we see the word picture of a tree being planted with deep roots and rich soil. We see the word picture of a building that is being built and how our lives are to be edified, and we add to our faith till we grow to the full measure of the stature of Jesus. Thirdly, we see that we're in God's classroom. We're established in our faith just as we were taught. And then lastly, abounding and thanksgiving. Abounding is one of the favorite words that Paul uses. The word picture is of a river that overflows its banks. Some translations say overflowing. The NIV says overflowing. I think the New American Standard says overflowing. The King James and the ESV says abounding. And abounding is one of Paul's favorite words. As a matter of fact, it really helps us understand the word picture, because when Paul talks about where sin did abound, it's talking about waves. You can picture a river overflowing its banks. Where sin did abound waves, grace does much more abound. Grace much more overflows the waves of sin. Praise God. Amen. And watch what he says. A Christian who's maturing, a Christian who is progressing, this is what he's going to look like. Their roots are going to be so deep in Christ, no catastrophe is going to overtop them. And then their lives are going to be so built up in Christ that they're just adding joy and faith and love and patience. They're just adding to their faith, to where they're being built up. And then they're learning in the classroom. I mean, they're absorbing, they're soaking in those lessons that only God can teach us. And you know what it results in? A river that's overflowing. And thankfulness. Oh. Thankfulness just overflows and overflows and overflows out of our hearts. And people will come and they'll say, but given your situation, how can you be thankful? Oh, you don't understand what God's doing in me. You don't understand how God is helping me. You don't understand how God is strengthening me. Do you understand what I'm saying today? And so sometimes we're in a season of life where the most spiritual thing we can do is just put the next step in front of the other. Go on and take that next step. Because let me tell you, God's working. God is working. And if you'll allow those roots to grow deep, if you'll allow your faith to be built up, if you'll allow God to teach you the lessons that you must learn to be who God intends for you to be, then what's going to be the result? You're going to be thankful in every circumstance of life, in every stage of life, in every season of life, in every hardship of life, in every sorrow of life, in every loss of life. You will know what it means to be thankful, and like a river that is overflowing its banks, thankfulness is just going to come out of you. Oh, I want to be that kind of Christian. I want to be that kind of Christ follower. So God, help us today. Help us to learn the lessons that you're teaching us. Help us to allow those roots to get deep. Allow us to have our faith built as only you can build it, oh God. Rather than grumbling, rather than complaining, rather than why is me or woe is me, know what we have is a faith that cannot be shaken. Hallelujah. A faith that cannot be shaken. A faith that cannot fall or falter, but a faith that is strong in Christ Jesus. Why? Because the roots are in rich soil. The building is being built up. The classroom is faithfully attended. And the river is overflowing its banks with thankfulness. God, I want to be that kind of person. I want to be that kind of father, that kind of husband. I want to be that kind of pastor. I want to be that kind of man, that kind of Christ follower. So Jesus, we invite you, do your good work in us. that means chiseling us, that Holy Spirit chisel. If that means taking us through the valleys of the shadow of death, and God will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. If that means taking us through the fire, well, we know what Isaiah says, the flame shall not kindle upon us. If that means leading us through the flood, we know what the Bible says, it will not overtake us. You do in us, O God, what is good, what is necessary, and what is right. And at the end of the day, we'll say the Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, church, thank you so much for joining.